Every circumstance, we come before you right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's declare and praise God this morning. Let's sing together. Everyone who longs for truth.
His love brings down.
Lord, you are God that, Lord, existed from before time began. That's why, God, we know that we can worship you and we can stand firm in you. So, Lord, we choose to worship you this day, oh God. Jesus, we worship. Let's sing. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. We sing. You are God alone from before time began.
You are God.
Lord, we pray that even as we move on to the next segment of this service, Lord, we ask that your presence be with us. And that God, we thank you once again for your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. We thank the Lord this morning. Not only are we able to be connected with God, but also virtually with one another in this online service. A very warm welcome to each and every one of you out there watching in. Praise God. The Bible enlightens us in Proverbs chapter 11, verse 25, that says, "A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed." Amen. Generous living is a key part of seeking God's kingdom and will cause us to prosper. The life of a true follower of God is refreshing in itself. And therefore today, as you get your offering, tithes, and mission giving ready, believe you will prosper and also be refreshed, simply because this is promised in God's word for you and I. Come, let us look to the Lord in prayer and believe the promise of God's word will come to pass in all of our lives as we worship the Lord in our giving to Him. Let us pray. Father, we are so grateful this morning that we can stand on the promise of your word. And as we give to you as a form of our worship, truly your word promises us we will prosper and we will be refreshed. And so I pray that you will bless the gift and the giver and use it for the expansion of your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. And as you can see on the screen right now, the different modes of giving via online, through bank transfer, or you can scan the QR code for PayNow through your different or favorite banking apps. Alternatively, you can continue to send in your check to our address at 1079 Serangoon Road, 328182. Do make sure you cross out the check and write out to Elim Church, Assembly of God. Or book an appointment with our admin staff every Friday to hand in your giving. Do make sure you WhatsApp us at +65 6298 2204. And the admin staff will be glad to meet you and collect from you. On behalf of the church, we want to say a big thank you for your faithful giving and your generosity. Praise God. Now, coming Wednesday, we will continue to meet for our miracle moments via Zoom. We thank the Lord for giving us such an opportunity to be able to be connected through prayers for the needs of the body and for one another. So don't miss out this coming Wednesday night at 7:30 p.m. Perhaps you have yet to join us. It is still not too late to register your interest, and we'll be sure to send you the Zoom link for your participation. Praise God. As we round up the month of November, focusing on parenting, intentional and effective Christ-based parenting by looking for ways to extend God's grace. Offering your child grace is not a sign of passive parenting, but a sign that you have received grace and are willing to offer grace in return. Grace doesn't ignore or excuse wrongdoing, but acknowledges that making mistakes is part of the human experience. And that as imperfect people, or even for that matter, as imperfect parents, we are still learning how to live with and love one another. Being loved unconditionally, even in the midst of big feelings and mistakes, speaks volume to your child. It eliminates shame, sending the message you are loved because you are you, not because you are perfect. I thought this was so appropriate for us as parents, both my wife and I, especially our youngest child who have just gotten his PSLE result this week. Now, the night before, we took the opportunity to set him down to calm his anxiety before he proceeded to the school to get his result. We informed him, we instructed him, and more importantly, we affirmed him that no matter what the results are, we love him for who he is. And so have a great week ahead by extending God's grace in the life of your child. Amen? Praise God. Now, without much ado, and before we hear the word of God this morning, I ask you to prepare your heart, perk up your ears, and give your full attention to a servant of God who is sharing his word to us today. It's my honor to turn this remaining time and welcome her to the pulpit. Please join me in welcoming Pastor Catherine Chan.
Hi everyone, it's good to have you with us. May the peace and the joy and the grace of God be with you. Mansoul was a fortified city with towering walls. It had five gates, namely the Ear Gate, Eye Gate, Mouth Gate, Nose Gate, and the Field Gate. Mansoul had an enemy called Diabolus, who attacked her on a daily basis. The interesting thing about this battle was Mansoul could never be defeated by external attacks, as Diabolus could never win in his assaults against the five gates. The only exception is when someone from inside opened one of the gates for him to enter. Time and time again, Diabolus spoke seductively at the Ear Gate and enticed it with fraud, craftiness, and hypocrisy. He also presented vivid, enticing messages, images at the Eye Gate. One day, the guardian of Mansoul, Captain Resistance, and the Lord Innocence passed away. Suddenly, the townspeople saw the tree with the forbidden fruit. It was simply irresistible and they tasted it. They forgot about their good king Shaddai and his commandments. They opened the Ear Gate and the Eye Gate. Eventually, Mansoul was conquered and came under the evil rule of Diabolus. From this allegory story written by John Bunyan, we learn that the city of Mansoul was captured and destroyed from the inside, not outside. Just like the city of Mansoul, sin will seize every opportunity to lure and entice us. But sin can never force its way into our lives. Sin can only enter by invitation. Satan did not force it upon Eve to eat the forbidden fruit. He did not force Cain to kill his brother Abel. Neither did he force upon the Israelites to worship a golden calf. He definitely did not force it upon Judas to betray Jesus. Every single one of them opened their eyes on their own free will to temptations and allow sin to come into their lives. When we let down our guard, open our gates, we are the ones who permitted sin to enter into our lives. The Word of God in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23 instructs us to guard our hearts. The title of my sharing today is Inside Out, and the scripture text is from Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 to 27. We are clearly instructed and warned to pay careful attention to guarding our hearts from the inside out. The inward conditions of our hearts affect our outward behaviors. The first thing we need to do is to examine our inward heart. Our heart determines the course of our life. Verse 20 says, it says, above all else, guard our heart, for everything within you do flows from it. The Hebrew word for heart is best understood as the inner person. It is the seat of our mind, our emotions, and our will. D.L. Moody described our heart as the place of conscious and decisive spiritual activity. A person as a whole, his feelings, his desires, his passion, thoughts, understanding, and will. Our heart is like a sponge, and it will absorb everything that are fed to it. The stuff that we allow to enter into the innermost part of our heart will control the state of our heart and impact our lives. Just like a reservoir supplying water to tens of thousands of homes, the heart is like the reservoir of a person, for everything one does flows from the heart. If the reservoir is not kept clean, we would have polluted dirty water, which is useless for drinking, cooking, and bathing, and so on and so forth. Likewise, we must guard the heart, the wellspring of our life, lest contamination spreads, hidden appetites uncontrollable, and festered wounds harm not only us, but also people around us. Hurting people hurt people. Our heart determines the course of our lives, so let's guard it at all costs. And to do so, we need to make sure that our heart is guarded with the Word of God. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 to 22. My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of my sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to those who find them and health to one's whole body. In verse 20, Solomon instructs us to pay attention to the word. It is not a one-off thing, but rather a continual giving of attention to the Word of God. When we stop giving attention to the Word, we become vulnerable and are exposed to the enticing tentacles of temptation, trapping and entrenching us in deeper sin. The word keep in verse 21 has to do with the meaning of guard, as in to watch over, to protect. It is like a soldier standing on the wall, watching over the enemy. However, in this verse, it is not what Solomon was saying. The biblical picture here is a guard watching over a prisoner so that the prisoner does not break free from the prison. We are asked, therefore, to guard our heart, not only by keeping things from entering our heart, but to protect and to keep something precious securely inside the heart. In Psalms chapter 14, verse 1, only the fools says in their heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. Their actions are evil. No one of them does good. You see, when we have foolishness and lies in our heart, our lives will be sinful. The lies in the heart are the source that cause a fool to do evil things, evil actions. First, we are instructed to incline our ears to the word. Then, we are asked not to lose sight of the word. Most importantly now, we are commanded to keep the word of God within our heart. This presents us with an idea of continually keeping up with the sense of guarding, protecting the word of God in our heart. We are not to forget the word nor ignore it. We are not to lose the word of God in our heart nor let godless ideas in. Charles Bridges, an English preacher from the 18th century, said, if your ears were bought to the doors of the sanctuary, if the word were never let out of your sight, your religion would still just be an idea and not principles, unless you keep them within the heart. Why must we guard our heart with the word? Verse 22 tells us, for, that is because, they, the word of God, are life to those who find them and health to one's whole body. You see, more than just a guide for living, the word of God is life to us. John chapter 6, verse 63, Jesus said, the words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Yes, the word of God is like life to us all. It is living and active. It quickens and enlightens us into building a vital, intimate relationship with God. It guides us in the path we take. It renews our spirit and transforms us. The word of God brings health and healing to the whole body, to the spirit, soul, body, mind. Brothers and sisters, as we keep and guard the word of God in our heart, we are actually securing and guarding our very own life. Any deviation or carelessness could lead us to a wrong turn or talk straight into the path of evil and its life-destroying areas. Therefore, it is of utmost importance that you and I diligently guard the word of God within our heart. The word of God, which is the word of truth, the life-giving word. Our hearts are like the central command center, which govern and direct our behaviors. Reading from verses 24 to 27 that follow Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, we learn that if we guard our hearts, we will also be guarding our actions. And that leads me to the next point, the outward behavior. We are instructed in verse 24 to guard our mouth. The Bible says in verse 24, put away from you a deceitful mouth and put devious speech far from you. The Hebrew word for put away, which translated in the Septuagint, literally means to remove and figuratively to stop or do away with immediately. Not later, not tomorrow, not the next week, but immediately. A deceitful mouth has to do with the falseness of mouth. It is used to describe a mouth that speaks without integrity, not truthful and manipulative, either subtly or blatantly. While devious speech has to do with underhand, sowing discord, conniving, indirect kind of conversations. We are warned to guard our mouth because they can lead us into sin. And as children of God, we are committed to immediately put aside falsehood, corrupt talk, slander, malice, and on without further delay. You see, God desires that each of us becomes His mouthpiece, bringing healing and encouraging others through our words. But the devil seeks to steal, kill, and destroy. He is striving and inciting you and me to blow up and cause dissensions and devastations with our mouth. Some complaints here, a few hurting words there, more critical words and profanity, relentless streams of tiny weeny gossips on the side. Guess what? When we succumb to that, not only do we give the enemy the opportunity, but also permission to make us his instruments of terror, of tearing and spreading others apart. The enemies know the extent of the damages we can cause if we do not bring our mouth under the control of God. We have need to exercise discernment and discipline to guard our mouths from lying and misleading others. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 10 tells us, whoever would love life and see good days must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. Friends, I'm sure all of us love life and want to see good days. So let us speak love. Let us speak truth in love. Allow what is good for necessary edification that come out of our mouth to impart grace to others. I came across a short article on when to rein in our tongues. And it says, if you are in the heat of anger, if you may have to eat your words later, if you can't speak without yelling, if your words will damage someone's reputation, if your words would convey a wrong impression, when you are critical, when you are tempted to tell an outright lie, if your words will be a poor reflection of the Lord or of your friends and family, that's when you do not open your mouth. Have we been mindful about what comes out of our mouth? Are our conversations peppered with criticism, gossips, hurting words, insults, immoral jokes, or insinuation instead? May our words be seasoned with grace and salt so that we can bring glory to our Master and King. Besides guarding our mouth, we need to guard our eyes. Verse 25 says, let your eyes look straight ahead, fix your gaze directly before you. We are instructed to fix our gaze unwaveringly before us, not to allow the gaze to deflect either on the right or to the left. It is like the blinders which are used on horses to ensure their vision is straight and forward moving, so that they would not be distracted by the left and the right along the way. Likewise, may we keep our eyes with the blinders to keep on looking directly ahead, fixing our eyes on Jesus and the author and the finisher of our faith. Our outlook determines our outcome. Abraham, the friend of God, walked by faith in God and looked for a city whose builder and maker is God. But Lot, he became a friend of the world, walked by sight and moved towards the wicked city of Sodom. You see, each of us has our vision set before us, something we set our eyes on that guides our values, our actions and plans. Are your eyes yearning to own the glittering things that the world considers as valuable? Are your eyes looking lustfully at something it is not supposed to? Do your eyes stay focused, fixed on Jesus? May we follow David of old to turn our eyes away from the worthless things, to set no wicked things before our eyes. You know, often we have underestimated the power of media in our lives. All the types of media that we watch, the music, the YouTube, the TikTok, the Facebook, the Instagram, the Snapchat, Twitter, TV programs, Netflix, movies, newspapers, email, advertisement, gossip. We have allowed those contents not only into our eyes, but infiltrating our brains. Have we been careful in guiding what our children are watching? Have we ourselves been discerning and selective enough? We should not be naive about it. When we open our eye gates to the media around us, it infiltrates into our brain. It's sufficient gets in, it will make its way to our hearts. Matthew 6:22-23 tells us, the eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. And if then the light in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? Jesus warned us that our eyes can be a channel into our soul. They are a most dangerous inlet to sin. So guard our eyes. We are living in the days where the mass media bombards us and our children with publicity designed to arouse our appetites. We must stay determined to keep our eyes on Jesus and His words. Let's be on guard what we let our eyes linger. Finally, we need to guard our feet. Verse 26 to 27 says, "Ponder the path of your feet and let your ways be established. Do not turn to the right or to the left. Remove your foot from evil." Each of us must weigh our very own actions. Even godly people who love the Lord and are committed to Him must be careful about how we live. The imagery of the level, firm, and straight path is used to advise the disciple to keep away from evil actions. There is no middle way. We must turn down the wrong way and follow the right way every step on our life. It is easy to get too so caught up in this life that we lose sight of eternity and forget the significance of making good daily choices. There is a children's song that goes, which I'm sure all of us are familiar with. It says, "Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little feet, where you go." And this is so true, whereby we need to be careful where we go. Do not allow the allurements of the world distract us, but ponder and weigh every step in life as to whether it is of the Lord or not. Guard the direction of our feet are taking us. In conclusion, Solomon would have done well to take his own advice. However, it was mentioned in 1 Kings that as Solomon grew old and his wife turned his heart after other gods, his heart was not completely devoted to the Lord, his God. Solomon did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and that's where the Lord detests. While his heart was meant to be reserved for his maker and king, Solomon allowed his heart to be turned because he failed to take care of what flowed into it. He listened to nonsense about other gods and began to believe it when he should have devoted himself to the word of God. What about you this morning? I believe that the Holy Spirit wants to speak to different ones. And even as every eye is closed and head bows, Holy Spirit is asking, "How is your heart, my child? Is your heart worn out? What fills your heart? Maybe there are much pains and hurts that you are keeping in your heart. Probably people may have disappointed you or may have spoken harsh words to you. Maybe you feel unfairly treated. Holy Spirit is saying to you, I believe, to come to Him and let Him renew you and refresh you. So this morning, brothers and sisters, wherever you are at, let's make this place an altar before God. Release those pain and hurts to the Lord. He wants to bring about healing and restoration to your heart. Let's spend some time praying the Spirit, wait upon God, and let Him begin to minister His healing, His joy, so that it can overflow in your heart. You know, as the musician plays, "Lord, I give you my heart. You know, as the song plays, you know, let you begin to yield to the Holy Spirit. You begin to respond to the Holy Spirit where the Holy Spirit point finger at that particular area. Oh, shakara babandara so riandara so rapapandariandariandari. Shariandarariandariandari. Oh, shakara babandara se bebondoro. Bariare kapandara se kenamas e. Shoriandara se. Oh, let it go. Oh, release all the pain to the Father. He wants to fill you up to the overflowing. Oh, shakara babandara so riandariandari. Shokoriandarara so rapapandara riandari. Oh yes, Lord, do a deeper work in us, Lord. Lord God, remove, Lord, even as we open our heart, Lord, we allow you, oh God, God, to do a deeper work, that even as we surrender, Lord, those pains, those struggles, Lord, those injustice which we may feel, whatever areas, oh God, that is choking or holding up in our heart that does not belong to you, Lord, we want to just leave it at your feet. And we want to receive your restoration and healing, oh God. Oh, shakara babandaras, oh, rapapandariandariandari. Shokoriandariandariandari. You know, maybe some of us may find ourselves letting down of our guts. Maybe for the past few days, for the past few weeks or months, that we have let down our guts, allowing our flesh to take over and open up the gate where we fall into sins. You know what? Holy Spirit is tugging at your heart, pointing finger and showing the weaknesses where you may have let your guard down. Even right now, just surrender to Him. Surrender to Him. Sometimes we find that it is so difficult to let it go because we have been holding, carrying it for long. But today is the day whereby God is saying, my child, deal with it. Confront it and have victory over that area in your life. Do not give opportunity for the devil to attack and bring you down. You know, brothers and sisters, let's not sweep it under the carpet. What we do not deal with will one day come back to deal with us. So, whichever area that the Holy Spirit is showing you, let's respond to Him, shall we? Because I believe why He show it to you? Because He wants you to have the breakthrough. He wants to cleanse you and set you free. Oh, shakara babandariandari. Shokora babandaras eriandariandari. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Shakarandares eh. Uko namasararandere. Shoko namasariandariandari. Lord, we lay it at your feet, oh God. Oh, shakara babandaras eke namaso rababandaras. Shakara babandaras o riendere kondararariandere. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm awake, Lord, have your way in me. Oh yes, begin to surrender to Him. Oh yes, God, you have our heart, Lord. God, we release to you, oh God. God, every breath that we take, every moment that we are awake, God, you have your way. Lord, even right now, God, we want to come before you and say that, God, we surrender, Lord, that area of our life that holding us up, oh God, that is choking us. Father, we just want to let it go to you. We want to live a life that is victoriously, that is victorious, a life that God set free, a life, oh God, that walk in steps with you, hallelujah, a life, oh God, that is full of joy, that of use for your glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Shakara babandaras o riandari andari andari. Mashakari de kondara babandari andari. Mashakari yendere kondara katara pandere. You know, most importantly, I feel that, you know, maybe there are some of us, you know, whereby we have not been guarding that what is allowed to enter into our heart. We have neglected the Word of God. We have neglected in reading His Word, in abiding and keeping His Word in our heart. And as a result, our life is weakened. Our spiritual life is weakened. You know, we succumb to the temptation very easily. But first thing first, we need to be guarded with the Word of God. And once again, you know, wants to ask God to, God, grant us a renewed desire, God, for your word, a renewed passion, a fresh desire, God, for your word, that God, I may hide your word in my heart. That not God, like not whereby God, it has been a while, but every day, every minute, God, I will keep your word. I will live by your word. And we want to do that. We begin to ask God, God, may you empower us. Brothers and sisters, this is a decisive decision that is not stirred up emotionally, but our will must be in the picture. Decide that, God, from this day on, Lord, I want and I will every day to read and meditate on your word. And not just read and meditate, but God, I will live by it and keep it in my heart. Thank you, Lord. Father, we want to thank you for your word. We want to thank you because, Lord, we know that, God, you have spoken. And Lord, we are so grateful to you because, Lord, not only as you have spoken, you desire us, oh God, to experience, oh God, a greater measure of faith, a deeper walk with you. But most of all, God, we will be so rooted in your word that our heart will keep your word in every moment of our life, because it is when we guard our heart with your word, that's where, Lord, we will live a life that is pleasing. We will live a life, oh God, that is powerful, allowing you to use us, as well as, God, we will impact many other people. And just as your words say, God, your word brings life and brings health to our being. Your word is life. So today, God, we ask that, Lord, you will empower us, you grant us the grace and the strength to do it on a daily basis. Thank you, Lord. God, even as we move on and end the service, God, may your presence goes with us, that even for the day and weeks to come, we will always be so conscious of your presence, of your goodness, and guarding our heart with your word, guarding our mouth, our feet, and our eyes too. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. Lord, may your blessing goes with all our brothers and sisters in Christ, because you are the God of blessing. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen. Praise the Lord. So, brothers and sisters, God bless you. And do remember to guard your heart with the Word of God, as well as to guard our actions. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you. May the Lord richly bless you.